doing like this? You can hear? Great. I'm Julie Spencer, Assistant Superintendent of Research and Accountability in Durham Public Schools. And although we partner with many different groups, the one we're kind of highlighting today is our partnership with Duke and the Durham Children's Data Center. And so Beth and I, we're kind of together on this panel because we're going to be talking about the same partnership.
Great, so I'm Beth Gifford. I'm the director of the Durham Children's Data Center. Would you like a little description of the data center?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that'd be great.
Great, so the data center started in January of 2015, and it largely came out of this desire, I think actually driven partly from the county manager's office, to make decisions based off of, to use data to help make resource allocation decisions. And so from that emerged a group that became our executive board, who's composed of the Durham Public Schools superintendent, an assistant county manager, the director of the North Carolina Education Research Data Center, which some of you might use in your own research, and the director for the Center for Child and Family Policy. And so that group of four individuals sets the priorities for the Durham Children's Data Center. Right now we have three MOUs, one of which is Durham Public Schools. We also have an MOU to work with Durham Social Services and the Durham Partnership for Children. The way that we're staffed, we have one statistician who works about half of his time in Durham Public Schools. He works off of a Durham Public Schools machine and basically has access as if he's a Durham Public Schools employee. So he has a staff badge and works within there. And then we have about half of my time and then a little bit of a staff assistant. We have two types of projects. We have a type A project, which is largely it's questions that are posed by agency directors that our staff then work to answer. And then we have a type B project, which would be your typical research project that would go through the institutional IRB plus any IRB or review process that the organization has. I think that's...
Can I add in, so from kind of taking that umbrella from a school perspective of the Durham Public Schools district in relationship to the Durham Children's Data Center, kind of thinking about our current projects. So we do type A projects. So they are initiated by our organization and questions that we sometimes are guided by our community or our board or just the kind of really getting at truthfully research questions that we just don't necessarily have the capacity. We do not have a large department, and so we do not have the capacity within to just spend days digging into a particular area of emphasis. And so, for example, I think of our projects in three kind of umbrellas. One has been around preschool, pre-K, and kindergarten readiness, and I would say that one is was very big in kind of the launch of the Durham Children's Data Center and Partnership for Children in Durham, of really looking at our students arriving in kindergarten. So that's one project. Another one is around K-3 literacy and just really exploring the literacy skills of our youngest students. And then the third one is around graduation / dropouts and understanding who our dropouts are, as well as who are students who are not graduating, which may or may not always be in the same category, and really breaking that down. And so those are kind of our three big current projects, and then we have some kind of smaller projects that have stemmed off, but those are our larger ones.
Is Durham the only city that's doing something like that? I mean, I know people have been talking about it for a long, long time. I didn't know if, as you guys were getting ready to set it up, if anybody else in North Carolina at least had actually matched those, you know, gotten that match done.
Yeah, I don't know about another group in North Carolina.
Mm-hmm. Ours was not necessarily modeled. I mean, I don't know anyone, so it's not necessarily modeled after another.
Great. Oh, that's really exciting.
It was perhaps most closely connected, however, to what Beth was saying with already having the data. So system for the state education day.
That's great. Thank you all so much for sharing that. I think next up we've got Matt Militello.
Hi, I feel like I'm on a panel of Unplugged from MTV. I need some instruments up here with the microphone, so I have no musical talent, so people won't get that out of me. So happy to be here. I wanted to spotlight just briefly three different aspects of some of the work I do with under the broad umbrella of partnership. My research has really shifted to work with, I do educational leadership, so preparation of school principals and superintendents, and half of it's talking people out of doing it, and half of it's preparing them to do it. And as a former administrator myself in K-12 schools, I kind of see both aspects, and trying to blend the research with practice all the time, which is not always easy to do. Sometimes we do more harm than good by trying to merge those two together. But I'll talk about my last slide a little bit of what we're doing to remedy that. So my focus of most recently is on reframing community partnerships in education. And the work is really around community engagement and community partnerships. And we use the word exchange because we truly believe that that if we're training folks to work in communities, they shouldn't be working for the community, they should be working with the community. We're not missionaries, we're working with folks. And that's a pretty actually big mind shift to get people to move away from. A couple of voices that we're finding that are often completely left out of the conversations beyond the community writ large. We think of the community as our students and our parents, but community elders are a bastion of knowledge. We've been doing these community learning exchanges in Greenville, East Carolina. We've been specifically working with seven different organizations. The one that's been most fruitful has been the EPS Alumni Association. So one of the last segregated high schools in Greenville, in all North Carolina, has a very strong alumni association that has so much to offer and to give. And what we found is that when we started to work with the folks is that they were, a lot of school folks and university people didn't want to, unpeel that onion, thinking that it was going to be filled with trauma, when in fact it was filled with hope and aspiration, and we're finding that there are really good partnerships are developing. So the work that we do with community learning exchanges essentially is to bring in community members to start thinking about the solutions to issues. Most community learning exchanges, they can happen for 2 hours. Most of them happen all day on Saturdays. We just had one recently. I'm working with five assistant principals in Cook County. I asked each of them to bring a team. The team consists of themselves as an administrator, a parent, a student, an elder, somebody from the community. We pick a topic. It might be around engagement in middle schools and parental engagement. And we ask folks for, usually the morning part is to unpack some of the trauma that has occurred. There's always obstacles in the way of why something's not happening, but we certainly always shift over to the hope and move into action planning. It's those action plans, I believe, are ripe for partnerships with research, with action planning, with trying things that we often don't engage in. The big lesson from this slide about partnerships with the community is this, that the solutions to issues that we have reside in the very communities we're trying to fix. And for those of us that think that we can come in from the outside and impose something on them in a context that's unlike ours, I think is inappropriate and can do more damage. So, we've really been working on the community aspect as an asset and the power of the people to do that. The other is, I think there's another slide, Matt. Is there one previous to that one? Oh yeah, right there. This one's great. So the other thing that I've been working on, I don't do a lot of grants external. I see Beth Cassidy here. I used to work here at NC State. She's going to shake her head. A lot of the work I do with grants are from foundations, which are awesome, but they don't bring big overhead to the university. When I was here at NC State, we had some work with the Kellogg Foundation. I've been working with the W.K. Kellogg Foundation for quite a while, and they are deeply embedded. And actually, they funded the initial work that came to fruition that we did these community learning exchanges. Most recently, I've been working at some connections at the Panasonic Foundation. So I moved from cereal to TVs, and they do more than just TVs. But Panasonic has a foundation, a small foundation, but it's completely devoted to education. And they do district-wide interventions, and actually one of the things I liked about the way that they work is they visit the schools and they ask the schools what they need. So it's a true partnership. So I've partnered with Duplin, Jones, Pender, and Sampson counties And we're working, and this really should be low-hanging fruit, that we should think that a principal should be able to walk into a classroom diagnosed with good teaching is. That's not necessarily the case. And more importantly, once they do and have the skill and the game to actually do that, they don't have the chops to actually sit down with somebody and tell them what's right or wrong. We find, and I'm part of the problem because I help prepare folks that go into these schools, is that we find that, you know, even if you're really good at that and you get into the room with a teacher and you need to talk to them about teaching and their pedagogy, oftentimes they become an attorney and they do all the talking and, you know, an apologist for the actions that they saw in the classroom. So what we're doing, the group just came back from New Orleans where we had some work with other districts from the country. The partnership is focused on training the school principals with some coaching from Panasonic Foundation. We're actually in the schools. We rarely meet in settings like this. We're doing the work in the schools. We're debriefing. And we're working on a diagnostic piece. Next year we'll move over to the meaningful conversations part of it. We have a couple of grad students that are part of this project that are actually practitioners at ECU that will be working on their dissertations as well. So we're trying to collect data as we go and so that we can find out what's working about this process and what's not working. And the last partnership I want to talk about is there's been a movement across the United States to move away from a PhD toward an EdD for practitioners, not for everybody, so don't get nervous, researchers. This is specifically for people, probably like me when I first went into my grad work, I thought I was gonna become a superintendent, and I probably, if there was an EdD available, I probably would have done that, but there wasn't at my university. But folks that want to stay on track and be practitioners. So this movement is to reclaim the EdD. This is not a new thing. EdDs have been around for a long time. So universities around the country are working with the Carnegie Foundation to reclaim the EdD. So at ECU, we have actually bought into this notion. We have a three-year program now, a three-year EdD, and that includes dissertation. That's fundamentally different than most programs that claim to have three-year programs, but three-year means get done with your coursework and good luck with everything else. A lot of the dissertation work for the EdDs around the country, I just got back from the Carnegie, we have two annual meetings. They've done things to, I hate to say make easier, it's not about making the dissertation easier, but it's about taking away some of the obstacles that are traditional for folks like you that work full time and are trying to get their work done. A lot of them gone to like a 3-chapter dissertation. We've actually gone to a 10-chapter dissertation. So our work is focused on every course, every semester you have a course, you have a content course, but you also have what we call a design course. And a lot of it is around design thinking and aspects of how you unpack and understand problems of practice and then work on them. Our students engage in action research. They do three cycles of action research. So every class they take, they're engaging in some aspect of that, and they're writing a smaller piece from the research that they're conducting. So they're actually embedded in schools. They're working on, we moved away from the terminology of problem of practice more towards focus of practice. I think we are way too deficit laden in our thinking. And start thinking about how we can actually have some impact. So the focus of practice that our students choose has to be something that has some targets. We use the Kellogg logic model. And actually stealing from Jenny's logic models that she's worked on here to understand the difference between impact and outcomes and short-term outcomes so it has to be something you can measure, but it has to be something that's going to have an impact on practices you as a practitioner. So we're piloting this in two ways. We started a new EdD program in Asia, and so we have a new program, three-year program. We just finished up our second semester in Bangkok. We have students from all over East Asia. Mostly U.S. and Canadian citizens are teaching in international schools that want a degree from a U.S. institution. So we were happy to fill that void. And we're also doing that work here. We have two of the dissertations I want to spotlight are two administrators at Central Office here at Wake County Schools that we were working on they successfully defended their dissertations recently, and they created focus of practice that had meaningful application to their practice. And one thing that's fundamentally different than what we do is that we try to do, this is not easy work, is to try to get participants of the studies to be involved in a data analysis. So this is, you know, oftentimes you're extracting information from practitioners, maybe later you're telling them what you learned and what they should be doing, but to actually engage them in the data analysis. That is, these two folks did some studies where they had some, they did some perception studies, one about long-term suspensions, and the other did around first-year principals. We had people sort and did factor analysis on people's perceptions, and the people that originally sorted the statements came back into the fold and gave some insights into why they sorted the way they did. So we're trying to find ways. This is not easy work. The relationship between higher ed and K-12 has always been tenuous because they feel as if, you know, we're sending students here to grab or to be on a grant. But I think there are, I think the purpose today is find those kernels of ways in which we can partner. It's probably less about institution, more about people, sadly. But finding the right people is a way in there. So I'll stop there and talk about those three partnerships.
Great. Thank you, Matt. And then we have Judy from Guilford County Schools.
I'm Judy Penny. I'm Director of Accountability and Research with Guilford County Schools. And we don't have as formalized partnerships. Yeah, I have a soft voice. And speaking about what you were saying, I'm used to standing in front of a mic, but I have a guitar in front of me.
Oh,
and that provides me with some protection. I feel more secure. So we have sort of, I would call them piecemeal partnerships with several different universities in our area. We have some partnerships between schools and universities. We have two of those, between individual schools and universities, and those are more around practice kinds of things where the university is, it's sort of almost like a lab school situation. But the faculty members do research in those schools, and they work closely with us to get approval for that kind of research. We also partner with one of our local universities that has a graduate program, an EDD program, that uses the problem of practice, is what they refer to it as, for their dissertation model. And we have a lot of their students who are people who work in our district. And so we try to work with them to pick a problem that's of interest to the district. And then we partner to help them do the research that they're doing. And hopefully to make it something that is related to our strategic plan or something that is of real interest to the district. That's another way for us to get some research done that needs to be done by using those students. I also meet with the students in that graduate program on a regular basis to talk to them about research and brainstorm with them about ways they can do their research projects. But what I'm going to really focus more on today is our partnership with the Harvard Strategic Data Project, which they've already talked about. We have a data fellow in our district, and we're very fortunate to have her, Dr. Akeisha Jones, who's a data fellow. She's been here a little over a year now in our district and has been able to move our research efforts forward in a big time way, because we do not have the same capacity that Wake has. Even though we're a larger district, we don't have the same kind of research people capacity. We also partner with UNC Greensboro. They have an ed research program, and I've partnered with them in two ways. I used to work for Winston-Salem Forsyth County Schools and had similar partnerships with them. We partnership with them to do psychometric analyses of our interim assessments. They have a center that does that kind of stuff for communities. And so their students analyze our data for us and make presentations to our staff about how we can improve the interim assessments that we develop ourselves. We also have a partnership with them where for $18,000 a year, we're provided a doctoral student in ed research, and that is that student's assistantship. So the student works with their faculty member and then also works with us, but we supervise the student, we provide the student with research projects to work on. And again, that helps build our capacity to do additional research that we just don't have the ability to do. But we get that student half time for the whole year.
Great. So we were going to do some questions, and anybody on the panel can answer. We do want to hear from everybody, obviously. And the intent here is, I think we've got like six questions we're going to pose, talk for about 45 minutes, and then do some half hour, and then do some Q&A from the audience. So the first one, and again, anyone can jump in, is what motivated you to begin the research practice partnership work? And that's kind of at the individual level, I guess, Matt, as you were referring to, versus organizationally.
Well, I can say for us, it was lack of capacity. Yep. We needed help.
Strategic use of resources.
Right. So we reached out.
You reached out to UNCG as a way to, okay. Mm-hmm. And that was based on your relationship with them from when you were in Winston-Salem?
Well, actually, I used to teach in that department.
Mm-hmm.
as an adjunct, and so I knew the professors in the department, I knew the head of the department, and when I arrived in Winston, our capacity to do research was so limited. I said, you know, we need help, so I thought I'm just going to reach out. So I did, and we set up the partnership there, and then I just continued them when I moved to Greensboro.
When you moved to Guilford, great.
I would say our motivation was certainly centered around, we mentioned earlier, the community dialogue around preschool. I think really launched us in, and for the school district, which I'm sure is not uncommon, just the challenge of sharing data in a way that you could potentially match it with other data sets, and doing it, you know, in a way that protects our students. And in a way that we feel confident that the data security is intact. And so I think ultimately, at the very beginning, it was really around our data sharing with the Durham Partnership, which that is your preschool data. And in Durham, and I don't know if it's this way everywhere, but pre-K is funneled through Durham Partnership versus the school system. So they have a lot more of your preschool classes in the community, and our need to kind of figure out how best to assist with our preschool classes to make sure that our kindergartners were ready to go, just thinking about it from a community angle. I would say maybe a secondary part of that is the idea of universal pre-K, and that's a continual conversation in our community, but without data to support kind of the dialogue around it, then your funding is just always hindered. And so I think it ultimately centered around preschool.
Yeah, and I guess I have a slightly different genre of answer. I think as an academic researcher, I really like having the partners from the schools who know the data and who are going to ultimately use the results or fail to use the results. And so versus working with large national databases and publishing in academic journals where it may or may not be written, I do enjoy answering questions that people really want to know the answer to, because it's going to inform their work the next day or the next month. And so
and we like that too.
I think that's an important point. I mean, I did work in schools because that's what I knew. When I first did my first academic job, I didn't know what I was doing. And there's no bells, and there was nobody telling me I needed to put out a fire somewhere. So for a lot of us that would do educational research, I mean, it's kind of home to go back into the schools. For other folks, it's a little more difficult. But I think that the matching of needs, I think one of the disservices that we often do is folks are coming out of graduate schools and going into academia with a clear line of research, and it doesn't necessarily match what's around them. It might be based on big data. And so I think we need to strike up more conversations to find out what the school's needs are and what expertise are available locally. So then again, you're not necessarily just bringing something that the school might not need, or school is, you know, looking for, you know, expertise. But especially in this area, in this state, I mean, we have so much expertise around in the universities and more specifically in the K-12 schools to do that. So functions like this are important. We need to do more of these to find out what are the specific needs of the schools and what assets can be brought to bear from the universities to help.
Yeah, I think, Matt, the quote that you pulled out earlier about improving the quality of the research is an absolute kind of goal of this kind of work. And also the piece about, Michael Quinn Patton does a lot of work around utilization-focused evaluation, that your evaluation, your research is only as good as people actually using it to make decisions. And so if you're asking the wrong questions, if you're using the wrong data, if you're the data interpretation piece, I think, is critical. Having the education partner, the district, the folks that are actually implementing, like the program implementers, helping you not just interpret the data, but also ask the right question, you know, that's of interest to them. Also thinking too about what are the right data, not just kind of data points, but timelines that fit within a natural school day. So you're not, you know, this data burden piece, I think, is something that from a research standpoint, you know, we're really focused on this idea of rigor and timelines, where school districts are, I mean, they're trying to educate kids, you know, and so figuring out ways to leverage what's already going on in schools for to answer some of these data points, I think is a critical piece that we all, as the conversations emerge over the day, will be emphasized, I think.
And I think, Jay, we come at this from such different angles. When, mm-hmm. I imagine a lot of professors in here have the same deal. When you're working with students around dissertations that are coming from K-12 settings, they want to fix something. I need to fix something. I mean, they're used to that. They're used to people coming in their office and they need a quick solution, and that's your job, is to fix things. But researchers want to investigate something. They want to unpack something, right? And it can be a lot more abstract, and you know, and that's a dilemma that we face. But what we've been trying to focus our students on with the ED especially is ultimately it comes down to changing behaviors. When you're working in schools, there's long-term behaviors that need to be changed, whether they're teaching practices or outright issues with how they're dealing with students and discipline aspects and policies. There's behaviors that need to actually change, and that is hard to do with just, you know, trying to solve a problem. And so that's where the research can actually have, you know, because it has to be more than just the research we provide. It's got to be changed literature. It's got to be about how personal things are to folks and how we can actually help them. So it's got to come from different, you know, different aspects.
And we had one of the conversations we had this summer when we were out in Colorado with the DBIR was this issue around a problem of practice. It seems so kind of negative focused, and so really thinking about, so you know, a solution of practice or something, you know, where you're really trying to make a change for the better was something that we heard from some of the other participants there. The next question is about pros and cons of entering into these types of partnerships. I'd love to hear from folks on the panel about what's worked really, really well, and then what are some kind of things maybe folks in the audience want to watch out for.
That's a tough question. So, I mean, it takes a lot of time, and it's trying to do things on the schedule sometimes the Durham Public Schools or school system needs them versus that it takes to do the work. Trying to align those two timelines is just challenging. And then also then you have an extra executive board who's at the same time, you know, wants to see the results too. So I think that's hard, just keeping everybody's expectations in line.
Mm-hmm. I think, I don't know if this is totally in the same realm of pro, but just kind of the what works. One of the things that I think that is common for us in our partnership is staying focused. And one of the kind of practices that we try to maintain is just having very clear research questions to begin with, so that we don't go into scope creep and end up in totally different places. And just that very simple concept. I mean, we have a very simple form when we start a project of what are the research questions. And they are in layman's terms. They are not, you know, academia language. They are what is going to, who are our students that are successful on the third grade EOG? What prerequisite skills can we find out about them? And so they're just, and so from a school lens, of course, that is exactly what I want to be able to take back to principals and instructional facilitators and teachers. And so it, by getting on the same page at the beginning with research questions, then everything we try to take back to that. And if we go into a scope creep, which sometimes we do, then we either try to ask ourselves, is this a separate project, or is this connected? You know, does this go on a back burner? Where does this fit in? And so just kind of maintain, I think the challenge, the con, is being able to stay focused. But that would be one of the things that's worked for us to try to maintain the focus.
Yeah, because I think there's a different language between academics and, you know, and practitioners. And so we've absolutely have run into that too. Not just, like you're saying, the scope creep, but making sure, like, that, I think that's a very early first step is really about clarifying language and being really explicit about timelines, about expectations for timelines, and then additional, and it's because you're interested in the work, interested in the kind of larger research question, and so you tend to, well, what about this subgroup, or what, you know, and it kind of,
exactly
it can, yes, exactly, it can kind of snowball. The other thing that we run into also is just how long it takes for like cleaning data, for like getting the data clean enough to actually run the analysis that the practitioner or, and I understand completely when a local school board member says, well, what about this subgroup? And you're like, you know, deer in headlights a little bit and saying, we'll get right on that. But then that requires creating an entire new, you know, could require a lot of hours behind it. What on the surface appears to be a very simple question. So managing those expectations, both of your stakeholders, especially board members, and then on the flip side, researchers really being honest about how long something's gonna take, you know?
And even one step further, just not even just cleaning the data, but making sure one understands all of the variables. So a lot of the assessments are new to me, and so trying to then figure out what the report should look like is not easy, especially since we're just starting. We have no example reports for some of the work we're doing, so we're creating scratch.
And that always takes a little bit longer. What about you, Judy, and Matt?
The data planning I see as a pro for our partnership, because we get graduate students who are only used to analyzing nice, clean data sets that they were given by their faculty member. And so it's very eye-opening for them that they have to clean data and that they have to understand these variables that are out of the realm of their knowledge base. So I see that as a pro. It really helps them.
I think that's a huge pro for graduate students. I mean, when they come and start working for us, same thing here. We're like, okay, remember everything that you were taught in your stats class and then just like throw it out the window, because none of those data sets do not exist in education, you know? And so I think that's a huge asset for graduate students that have had an opportunity to work with you guys and the realities of that, of what education data really looks like and how messy it is. So I think that's a great thing to bring up, I think, for improving that, you know, kind of the IHE experience too.
Yeah, but I think that demonstrates also the power of a partnership that's formalized. For a lot of us, the answer to the question is IRB, because we have to work not only with our own institutional boards, review boards to do research, but then the school districts. And so, because they don't talk, they have different processes and completely different timelines, and we're working with one, actually, with a student of ours right now that has an IRB at one university, but, you know, the other university accepted. So there's a lot of crosstalk that doesn't happen that really gets in the way a lot of times.
And we hear that from faculty members in our area that our research review process is too tough. But if there's not benefit to our district, we're probably not going to approve the research taking our students' time off.
Mm-hmm. And we've been hearing that a lot. I mean, to have a panel at some point about what that means, you know, to put that into lay terms of what kinds of things people are looking for would be really beneficial.
Mm-hmm. What do you guys see as some of the biggest gaps between researchers and practitioners? We've talked a little bit about some language, about some timelines. Is there anything else that you all see as a kind of a disconnect between the researchers and the practitioners?
I would say one of the biggest ones that's kind of interesting is, I think for the school system, everything needs to be off of the most recent data. And as a researcher, that's really challenging, right? Because as you talked about, just cleaning the data and getting it ready. By the time you're ready, it's a year late. It's very old. But, you know, that's old.
Yeah.
And then we say, oh, this is great for 2014-15, but can I get it for 15-16 data?
Yeah. And we're all operating under the approval by DPI. That means, yes, it has kind of been blessed at the state level as far as being, you know, accurate. And so then becomes the whole process of...
I think another... it is good. I think when we write a report, the first audience that we want to share it with is maybe the supervisors within central office, that they see it first before it goes any further. And also to get their feedback, which is great, but it also is an extra level of scrutiny to add into the timeline.
Mm-hmm. But I think we have to do... I agree we have to provide it to folks like administrators, but we have to also educate them on how to use the data. There's a huge misrepresentation of data that flows through districts, and oftentimes the teachers then are hit with used data, and the data that's on their desk might not be appropriate to use in the way that they're asked to use it by the administrators. So it's lost in translation from the actual research that's conducted. Because one of the huge challenges we have are about the actual the results. We want, you know, most recent results, but we also need to know the difference between cohort data that's longitudinal versus data that's a little more static. And so you know, I find this misfit that happens, that data can be psychometrically strong, but it's used in inappropriate ways, which makes it really weak. And that it's a problem across the board. You can't pinpoint any one person. If you're a teacher and your principal is saying, use the data, use the data, use the data, and here's the data, and you're using it, but it's data from students that you've never seen before or from last year, it's problematic. So there's a step missing with, especially with frontline administrators that are being told then to, here's the data, use it, and they're not quite sure how to use it, so they just push it.
And that's maybe, to me, that kind of goes, whether that's a place where the IHEs could step in and provide some of that capacity building to whether they build it into their graduate programs or even just as a partnership with the district. Like, have all your principals come in and we will do a short, 101 on interpreting relevant research. You know, I mean, that's an opportunity where, from a research practice partnership at the organizational level, I think that we have tons of great IHEs in this state and lots of great resources close enough to just about every single school district that could be a way to build partnerships and build relationships if making sure that our school administrators and district administrators know how to interpret and read and digest some of the new educational research coming out. Because a lot of times, too, I think the techniques change they've really evolved in the past, 20 years, just with, the statistics you're able to do now on big data sets with some of the new approaches might be ones that, especially some of our kind of more senior superintendents and, assistant superintendents might not even have been taught, when they were, so maybe something that we could do, that could be something that, like as a next step coming out of this, something that I know that the IHE is absolutely would be interested in helping to do that.
No, I was just thinking through similar things. I mean, just figuring out the right priorities is deserves a fair bit of time because each one of these steps takes time. So figuring out the project and communicating it with folks in the school system, that takes up a lot of their time too. And so you want to make sure you're choosing the right projects to invest in.
And something that we do a lot of work at the Friday Institute where we're feeding information back to to administrators and policymakers all across the state. And it's always interesting to me how a school administrator takes on this role of protecting the teacher from too much information. And I think that goes all the way down the line, So like the superintendent is trying to protect their assistant supers and the curriculum directors, and the curriculum directors are trying to protect the principals. And so somewhere though, the information, sometimes the information doesn't get all the way down to the people that actually need it. I don't know if y'all had, y'all are shaking your head.
Well, so I put on my teacher hat, my assistant principal hat, my principal hat, my assistant superintendent hat, and that's exactly what I do right there. but I think the key to like unblocking that is very rich dialogue about getting focused on what what the teachers need, what would literally be an action step, So there is so much research available, there is so much data available, teachers are just kind of, teachers, principals, educators in general, kind of hammered with this idea of making data-driven decisions. And so there is no shortage of an understanding that we need research, we need data, but it's when and how does that fit in with putting out the fire in the bathroom, literally, or the bus wreck, or, goodness gracious, these schools down east who are dealing with flooded schools, and where are we going to have class, and what materials are we going to use? And so, how do you unblock and get something that is kind of real deal, I can do something with this tomorrow, because that's what teachers want, and that's what principals want. They have workshops, and so somehow it's, I think Beth and I end up having really good dialogue because I do try to put that protection on what are we gonna take them? The principals, they don't want another workshop, And so, and I'll just give you an example that just, and I talk about it all the time, like we've been working for months and months and months on this K-3 and looking at our MCLAS data, and there are really no big surprises. And I think that's what teachers kind of, you know, so if you, or principals, it's not like we unveil like who the students are that we never knew were reading below grade level, but wow, here's the book level that our students have to get to be proficient, and it's not what the state says. And so here's our new target, and so here's kind of a very specific, concrete action step. And somehow taking research into an action step that's very, achievable is I think very helpful for our teachers and school staff.
And so I was just talking about how the IHEs could help build capacity for administrators, and then that to me sounds like the reverse, right? That that faculty need help in how to translate research into action steps. Like, it, you know what I mean? That's part of that building on that partnership piece, because it is, believe me, it is not a 25-page journal article, right? That is not what a teacher, that's not what a superintendent is going to push to their assistants all the way down. You know what I mean? It really
and that is
this. What actionable item can I take in my classroom tomorrow? And so it sounds like that would be a really good place for, I think, faculty and researchers like me to get support from the districts and some feedback on what that really looks like. You know, one of the guys that works here with me is a policy guy, and he's always trying to get me to boil my 100-page report into like 2 pages. You know, and it kills me. It just kills me to do that. And so, but some strategies about what that might. But that is the way that we get. That's a communication strategy for a teacher, you know, or a superintendent, whatever. So I think that would be that's a great recommendation too. Other folks have.
I was going to suggest we need some dialogue between district people, particularly superintendents and universities, in terms of what kind of research is going to be the most helpful for districts. Mm. What are the big questions that districts have that universities could help with research capacity?
It's the superintendent or the superintendents in the district. That's interesting. Actually, on Friday, I'm going to work with the executive committee with the Superintendents Association to talk to them about the data that we're making public for the Digital Learning Initiative, so that the superintendents can kind of push back and ask us which of these data points are most important for you for making local digital learning decisions. But it sounds like that could be a conversation maybe that it's not just focused on digital learning, that there's a million things that they're interested in, so maybe making that a broader discussion down the road. That would be another good action thing I could certainly bring up to the Superintendents Association more broadly. Matt, is there? Okay, so one of the next questions was about how do you guys see theory informing practice and practice informing theory? So as you're asking these kind of big research questions, it's kind of what we've been talking about. Do you have recommendations about translating and making that leverage one another instead of be in conflict?
I think you're asking the wrong person. I'm trained as a health service researcher, so I don't use a lot of education theory, except that
I try to use it in practical ways. So for implementation studies, for example, I use a lot of Everett Rogers' work, who did work at Michigan State, mostly in agriculture, trying to figure out why farmers weren't adapting technologies in the 50s and 60s, such as mechanical technologies, but also fertilizers and things like that. And did some empirical work to understand, what gets in the way of innovations? You know, what factors are involved? And some are very personal. There's other, Peter Maris writes about educational change in the stages of death and dying. Very personal, right? It's very personal how we accept and how we have fear and how we push and resist change. So actually, what I found is using some theoretical lenses helps not only explain or prognosticate what is forthcoming, what you can expect with bringing innovations to a school, I think that left to themselves, it's just teaching theory. It's just kind of in a vacuum. You know, looking at critical race theory is critically important, but looking at it unto itself is not as powerful as if you're looking at new discipline policies in your schools around restorative justice. Then critical race theory has really deep impacts. I've also been turning a little bit more to more of the pop theoretical stuff. The well, it's not really pop, still based on empirical works, but you know, Whistling Vivaldi is a book that came out a few years ago that talks about contingent stereotype threat, and it has been an absolutely powerful way to help inform school leaders is to understand what stereotype threat means for students and what it looks like, and it's based on a number of empirical studies about race and gender and athletes versus non-athletes and the impact it has on test taking and things. So I think there's a way to bring in theory, and because you know everybody has a theory, and so you know if you can bring those to bear on people's thoughts and overlay them and see how it explains things, that can be really powerful.
Mm-hmm. Great. Did y'all have any other theoretical frameworks that you kind of apply?
Subconsciously and directly from a practitioner, I mean, you know, I think my lens is just almost always the experiential, practical, this is what schools are dealing with. You know, I can think of an example where not too long ago we started really wanting to dig into attendance data and the impact, kind of K-3 impact, and we got, Beth came in with kind of the initial some initial tables and kind of just realizing that our tendency is always to go after the, so we're assuming students who aren't attending, those are the ones that are not proficient, and just recognizing that, well, our data is not really saying that. So like, I don't know exactly how that connects, but kind of the our tendency to go to the what is typical.
So you were doing some, you were exploring some of the assumptions that you like, especially through this new partnership, it sounds like, that Beth was able to push you guys a little bit and, you know, and say, does the data really show this assumption that you are always, that you're bringing to the...
I think this, I brought descriptive statistics and let them see what they saw.
Mm-hmm.
And that was sort of the takeaway that we get to focus on the students who are coming every day and are remaining in this relatively lower level of reading.
Interesting. Judy, anything to add? All right, so we have about just a couple more minutes, and I think I wanted to ask about results. Have any results contributed to leadership level decisions on programming and or policy that have come from this work?
Just get ready to.
Yeah, I'd say we're still in the first year, so I feel like our reports are still on the newer level and being shared kind of sequentially, but I think she's right that they're emerging.
So two of the three projects are kind of getting ready to really take off. So the kindergarten project, so one of the realizations is we just did not have a high quality data set of kindergarten readiness. And even though the state has a new kindergarten readiness assessment, we don't really have access to that data. So what does our, you know, Beth helped us with, what does our kindergarten readiness assessment need to look like? And then we really explored what kind of system do we need to manage it. And so out of our partnership came a new kindergarten readiness assessment, kind of policy that it was now a requirement for our students versus kind of the option. A little more oversight of the assessment from the district angle, grant funding that would provide all of our kindergarten teachers with devices that they could then input the data, and actually we explored different options of what to how to best manage the data, but we ended up just putting it in Google, in a Google Doc, And so, because actually Google can do some pretty great analytics, and it was going to give us what we needed to then be able to match with data sets kind of over the years. And so that's where we are. So we're just now finishing our first year of kind of this new assessment. The second project, which would be the K-3 literacy, out of all of the report, there's this one table that I call it the million-dollar document that I shared with principals and kind of had a little bit of an informative, this is the target as you work with your students. And then we just recently presented some of our in-class data, some of this data, to our Board of Education kind of in an elementary data kind of review. And so, and kind of taking us to the place of now, here are schools we need to dig deeper in because they're really getting something right. And then here are some that are just maybe some question marks. And just, I think that's where we are with that project.
No, that's great. Judy or Matt, do you guys have any kind of findings, like as you've had doctoral students or graduate students in your department?
Yeah, so we had a wonderful day for a grad student in Winston because the student had done prediction analyses of dropouts and found that if students entered, if they were still in eighth grade and 16, that almost 100% of those students dropped out. So he had some other findings also, but we asked him to present his findings to the superintendent. So he was very nervous about that, but on the spot, the superintendent made the decision to fix the business with kids being 16 and still in eighth grade, and she created two special programs at two of our high schools, and any kid that was 16 and in eighth grade was moved to the high school so they could say they were in high school, but they were doing eighth grade work and getting ready for high school. And so he left that meeting realizing the impact that his research had.
That's just great. Awesome. Mm-hmm. That's a great story. I love that. Mm-hmm. I know.
We had a similar finding with I think it was basically if you were retained in ninth grade, there was about a 50% chance of dropout. And I think that that's also on our list of what's our next step. And because we can identify those students in the ninth grade rather than wait 4 years.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I was going to say one other thing. So some research that Dr. Jones did as part of the strategic data project. In our district, we have to look at everything with an equity lens. And one of the things that we found, well, there's two things in projects that she was working on, but we were looking at predicting EOG performance based on DIBELS and TRC. And we found you actually can predict it, but it depends on your race. And so we had discussions about teacher bias, teacher expectations, and that kind of thing. We also did some, Dr. Jones did some research with our discipline data, the same thing, finding that kind of bias in referrals. So this year, all of the teachers in our district are going through sort of implicit bias training. They're doing it at their schools, but they're all getting 3 sessions for them to look at what might be their own personal biases. Oftentimes, we're just not aware of it. And I thought that, that's huge.
Another example of actually the power of when research is done to meet the needs of the district, and the data is answering a question of interest to the district, it really does have the potential to be there at the point of decision making with the leaders. Matt, is there anything
Well, just briefly, for the EDD students, it's a little smaller scale because we're looking at action research projects. So when they decide on their focus of practice, we talk about, what learnings might occur from this. And the application part of it is usually some kinds of professional development through performance. So, for example, I mentioned Andre Smith, who's an area superintendent here in Wake County that did his dissertation on understanding long-term suspensions, what works and what doesn't. So now he's, we built this in at the beginning, that he's going to use his learnings, not necessarily to set a mandate or a policy, because that can be dangerous, but to have some conversations with his principals, his area principals, say that, maybe even continuing that process of doing, a little bit more research. But now it's the principals themselves that are conducting it, trying things. This whole design-based research grid is about trial and error. It's about small iterations. It's coming back to the Deming model, right? I mean, we lost it for a while, but this, you know, the PDSA cycle needs to be alive and well, where we do rapid design, rapid implementation, measurement, and then instead of hanging it on the Christmas tree, taking a step back and seeing what works, what doesn't, removing things, trying something different.
Great, thank you all so much. And then I think, Matt, we are going to do some Q&A from the audience. If folks have questions for anybody on the panel, please feel free to jump in.
I might even speak loud enough, but is that fine? I'm a high school science teacher at Nightdale High School for Graduate Design, so I might be in the minority here, but I finished my graduate research last year, and my kind of question, and I love the idea of action steps for educators, because being an educator every day, I actually got an email yesterday from my principal that said, I know this is a lot, I know you've got all this going on, but we need you to do this and this and this. So we get that a lot as teachers, but how can we help those teachers that are beginning teachers, that they're the lateral entry teachers, and they haven't had graduate research, so they don't know really much about the process? And how do we get them to buy in? Because even if they're given an action step, they're given data, they don't really know the process, or they don't really know what to do with that. So I'm teaching in a classroom right now with a teacher next door who's lateral entry. She took a break for 7 years off of teaching, now she's back. And then another teacher, I think at our school, we're right now at about 30% VTs, beginning teachers. So how do we take all of those people that have undergraduate degrees but haven't really done any research and help them with that? So.
Yeah, once just when I was here at NC State, Jenny taught a course for us in a program that we had and did a lot with logic models. And that's something that are really powerful as an entree, because it's to some respects people look at it as short, you know, these goals in development, and so it's getting to the action steps right away of problem solving. But to build around a logic model, you have to look at what informs it. So what empirical evidence is out there to inform the development of goals, but there's also the fidelity of understanding if, you know, do we actually know that we can do this, and if not, we need some help, and then what is, you know, how do we track that? But then there's outcome development. So we found in the master's program that we had here at NC State that we use that as a kind of a focal point to help us get people into their comfort zone, because the language is pretty understandable, but then to build around it, both backwards in terms of, you know, what informs this logic model, but then also forward of how we're gonna measure this in the future. So, you know, logic models, they're in many different iterations. The one that Jenny uses is very similar to the one that the Kellogg Foundation, which is kind of the gold standard in foundation work of their logic model. But I think that, and I know that you do, Friday Institute did some work with the districts on that, especially around digital technologies. We found that with practitioners, it makes research attainable, it makes goal development attainable, it makes, more importantly, the understanding that they have to collect data as they do things to make sure it's working. Because the worst thing that you can teach teachers early on in their careers is that initiatives are gonna come, they're never gonna go. So they're gonna keep on layering on top of each other, and that's a really bad precedent. Mm-hmm.
Other folks have something specific to the new teachers or lateral entry?
I just think that's a really hard one, and you know, I think our schools are just, you know, the increase in beginning teachers as well as lateral entry teachers is increasing. And so it's really, you know, and I just put my first year teacher hat on of survival and, you know, how much can a person handle? And kind of thinking through, I do think that there is some kind of like grace period for beginning teachers, that the main goal is day in, day out, you gotta provide high quality instruction, you gotta know how your students are doing, you gotta be able to know what they're learning and if your students learned it, like kind of those are the basics. And then everything else is icing on the cake. But kind of from a practical angle of how would I talk to a beginning teacher about this concept, who hasn't had graduate courses in research and research design. And I almost think I would frame it like our school improvement plans. You know, so your school improvement plan outlines, here's your big overarching goal, then you have two or three other goals, Maybe one's related to school climate, maybe one's related to math, one's related to literacy, or however your school is, and then you break that down, you know, two or three more layers to get to the action steps, and then building into it, how are we going to check on it, you know, how often. And so trying to make it in a user-friendly, something they can relate to kind of format.
No, I actually think that that is a great point, especially for the educational researchers in the room. If you want a school, a principal, a teacher to understand whatever research you're talking about, to tie it to their school improvement plan is a really important piece, or the district. If you're working with a superintendent, if you're trying to get IRB approval, you better believe that it must answer a question, be aligned to the district's strategic plan, period. And that's something that we do at the state level too. We were doing some work around the digital learning plan, and as I was talking to, you know, Dr. Atkinson, I made sure that I was aligning and responding to those priorities that the state board just set. So that goes all the way down to because the beginning teacher, even they would know that there is a school improvement plan and these are the priorities for our school for this year, this whatever the cycle is that school is on. But that's a great point. Other questions?
This question is for Matt. I am the intervention coordinator at Heritage High School, and this year, or for the past couple of years, we're focusing on reaching out to our families who aren't quite as engaged in the school. So I'm curious to know about your community learning exchanges, kind of how you developed that, and then what findings you've had.
Well, maybe during the break we can talk a little bit more, but we've actually written a book about it, and we have an offshoot called what we call Parental Wisdom Exchanges. And so we found that bringing parents in, asking for their wisdom, as opposed to bringing them into schools. I mean, a lot of folks that we want the schools have some kind of a trauma about going into schools themselves, either from their own experience or from the traumas that they face from hearing negative things about their own children. And I think, you know, for those of us that walk into schools every day and we don't feel that, but there are places you do feel that. The dentist, maybe, you know, like somewhere that you feel some you know, trauma of trepidation going in. Could you imagine feeling that way all the time to a place where you're supposed to be welcome and supposed to give some of that to you? So we have quite a bit of writing about what they look like. We have a lot of video as well that we do. So I'd be happy to talk to you about this. But the key is to be invitational. We oftentimes have to hold these exchanges off-site, off campus, because that's not the place where folks are going to feel the most comfortable. In Eastern North Carolina, the EPS Alumni Association has been a really great inroads with us. The spiritual community is an amazing inroads for folks. And so we find ways in which to, the first step is to allow people to be heard. And you'd be amazed, and I mean, you're not amazed. You know it's always fruitful. It's just getting those voices amplified. So I'd be happy to talk to you a little bit more about that.
Great. We've got a couple more minutes. So another question from the audience.
So I think a lot of what I know, you're writing your reading. So I think a lot of what we've heard were a lot of partnerships that were tackling problems that were situated. They certainly touched in classroom problems, but they were situated more at the school level or district level. So what advice do you have for those of us that are really study teaching and learning deeply in classrooms? And I think this goes along with the question about beginning teachers and those action items that happen day to day in the classrooms that affect students' experiences in their teaching and learning. What advice do you have as far as establishing those partnerships that are at the classroom level?
One thing that we have at the Durham Children's Data Center is more, the idea is actually to bring in more faculty who are doing work. And I think it would be partnering with specific faculty members or even units within a university who are specifically targeted on curriculum development. The woman sitting next to you actually does do some curriculum development on English language proficiency, for example. So I think partnering more closely with someone who's on that topic.
I think doing more work just in the classrooms too. I mean, with this Panasonic Foundation grant that we got, we first took the four superintendents into some classrooms And we took them in for 15 minutes, and then we had a debrief. And we found them saying things, well, I think the teacher is trying to, and I think the mission was, and our coaches kept on just absolutely hounding them, saying, you didn't see it, it didn't happen. What actually happened in the classroom that you saw that you could write down? You know, how much time did the teacher do, you know, with specific aspects of their work? How much teacher talk was there versus student talk? I think for a lot of folks that the research has to get into that nitty-gritty, because if we're, again, it's about changing behaviors. If in fact we want to change pedagogical behaviors of teachers in the schools and we want to reflect more on student learning versus teachers teaching, then we have to give them meaningful feedback. And you can't do that by walking in and saying, I did a 10-minute drive-by from your classroom and I put down good job, or, you know, get students more engaged. And so I think that some of that research has to be those really difficult, you know, having people willing to have those difficult conversations. And we had four courageous superintendents who were willing to do that. They put themselves in a line, and it was quite embarrassing, with the lack of knowledge that they had about what was actually going on in the classroom and what they wanted to say versus what they were actually seeing. And so, but it was courageous to the point where they're bringing their principals on board. We're doing the same kind of training. So it does, I mean, this bigger aspect of research is important. It's important to all of us, and we do that, but we also realize that if it doesn't infiltrate the classroom specifically, and we're changing things are happening, it's, you know, it's all for naught.
And
that,
yeah, go ahead.
I just want to tag on to both of these, which kind of from a very practical standpoint of, so how do I even navigate that? You know, do I call Duke University? Have you got any buzzers? But I think kind of two pieces to that. One, somebody in your district kind of manages research, so letting them be aware of your interest. Also letting your whoever, I think letting the principal know, because sometimes they have opportunities that they may be protecting teachers from, and they're like, no, stay away from my folks. And really, you have great interest in that. And so I think letting principals know, letting your research contact know, and then also letting your human resource folks know, whoever manages student teachers, because oftentimes that is definitely a way into kind of working with universities. I think that's one practical. Another practical, and I don't know all the details of this, but I know that there are some new very rigorous requirements for our teachers that are in university now preparing our future teachers. And so around, like, every year they have to have field experience that is what has not been required over the years until right now. And so I think I had a recent conversation about a couple weeks ago with several university folks. They're really struggling with how in the world we're going to do this. And so I think even connecting with your whoever works with student teachers to give you contacts, because I know, for example, Peace was the one I was talking to, you know, how are they going to manage these requirements and getting enough teachers and classrooms. And so I think just making sure people know of your interest is important.
And real quick, there's during concurrent session four, there's an example of a research teacher partnership.
Right. I was actually going to say, to Hollyland's point, that that it sounds like one piece of conversation that should be flowing through the remainder of the day is the teacher voice, right? And not just how to get the teacher's voice kind of connected to the research community to make sure we're asking the right questions that inform their practice, because there's, you know, they're not going to use the data and the research if it's important to us. It has to be important to them, right? And to help inform, and from a new teacher perspective too. I mean, they're so overwhelmed with the everyday, with, you know, just getting through the day, that making sure that the communication strategies that we're, has to be informed by their needs, has to. So I think that kind of, we can, everyone made, I think, a lot of great points during the panel, but this real kind of commitment to the practitioner and the teacher's needs and improving instruction and making sure that the as researchers and the research community that we're open to their recommendations, since they're the ones in the classroom. But I would like to give everybody a hand on the panel. Thank you so much.